looking at the bar table. They're taking their seat on the left. Mililani Trust, Kalamani Hill. Mililani and her sister Haunani Kate Trask. I remember at the first revived La Ho'iho'i in 1987, I believe it was, with a serious with a serious aim of restoring Hawaiian independence. If you're new to this, the people think Hawaii is a state that was a territory that was annexed in 1897. The problem is there's no treaty of annexation. It was done by a joint resolution of Congress. You can't run around annexing countries with a joint resolution of Congress. Anyway, there are many who want to reassert the independence of the Hawaiian nation, and this has suddenly gained some prominence.
Oh, my kapo!
I'll talk to you later.
How's the food? Let me give a round of applause for all the people that prepared the meai. Hello, my kapo. My name is Joshua Yohane Noma. I'm from the Ahupua Kali Palama. I'm a Farrington graduate, so welcome to my house. I want to Aloha Aina organizer. I, along with many people, helped to put this 100% grassroots community event, informational event, on for you tonight. Yeah. And for the people in the live feed. Yeah. I want to tell you a little bit about what Aha Aloha Aina is, who we are, and then we will get into our program. Hiki no?
Hey.
Aha Aloha Aina is a coalition of individuals, businesses, organizations that are committed to the reaffirming our independence and the restoration of the Hawaiian Kingdom. We work collectively on a model of self-governance that is completely independent out of the control of the state of Hawaii. We have conducted over 30 community meetings on the islands of Oahu, Maui, Hawaii Island, Lana'i, Molokai, as well as in Moku Honu, in cities like Salt Lake City, San Diego, Los Angeles, Seattle, Washington, D.C., as well as New York City. Over the past year, over 3,000 people have participated in Aha Aloha Aina, in our model, our Kino model of self-governance, and reaffirming our things. Okay. Now, we believe, both working with Kanaka and non-Kanaka, we provide a true model of self-determination that is independent from the control of the settler state. While we work toward our ultimate goal of independence from the oppressor settler state, many of us are also on the front line of social justice issues, fighting for the protection of our water, to stop the desecration of our natural resources. We fight for affordable housing for all people. We fight for universal health care, to increase our teachers' pay here in Hawaii, fighting injustices done to our houseless ohana, and many other countless fights that not only improve the quality of life for Hawaiians, but for all people of Hawaii. Those who help to organize Aha Aloha Aina are also lawyers, teachers, cultural practitioners, medical doctors, college professors, students, trade workers, bus drivers, community organizers, social workers, farmers, fishermen and women, nurses, bus drivers, musicians, kumuhula, graphic designers, hunters, engineers, journalists, poets, artists, and these are just the people that I know personally. There are many kupuakua in our efforts that I don't know, and I don't know what they do to support their families. But I mahalo their selfless contributions to our Aloha Aina. While we work toward our ultimate goal of independence from the oppressor settler state, okay, we also understand that we need to fight and engage and protect our resources that are at stake right now. We invite you, those Kanaka and non-Kanaka who would like to get involved in Aha Aloha Aina, please go to www.ahaalohaaina.com. You can also get more information by going to our Aha Aloha Aina Facebook page or going to our Aha Aloha Aina YouTube. Mahalo.
Mahalo.
I mahalo each and every one of you, and I especially mahalo our enthused who are here tonight. That is something that I welcome. But I welcome your criticism with civility, with aloha, and with love. Sticking to the issues and leaving the personal task on the side. I will let you know that we organized this to kill three myths, okay? That Hawaiian Kingdom men are violent. We are far from violent abusers. We are nurturers, we are fathers, we are caretakers of our ohana, of our ahuwa'a, and of our mohi. Okay? Two, we're gonna kill this once and forever, that independence people are ignorant, are stupid, and uneducated. That is far from the truth. And tonight's forum, as well as our Aloha Aina, is gonna continue to disprove that myth. And three, most importantly, a myth that we are going to kill once and forever, that Lahui Kanaka or Hawaiian people cannot gather in a room together and have differing opinions and it be okay. I mahalo Anake who just booed me right now, and I mahalo her voice, because that is the type of voice, inclusive voice, that we encourage at the Aha Aloha Aina. That is the type of voice that is a true example of self-determination. I would like to thank you. So with that, I want to thank some people first that are making this possible. You see some of our speakers are being presented with ava. Sister T. Henderson that brought some ava, right? We have our kia'i. You see them in the red shirts, okay? If you was earlier, they blew the poo. You identify them in the red shirts. Our kia'i or our protectors. They are those that are going to help us to hold the conduct of aloha so that we can continue to be successful in this meeting that we want, okay? So I'm just going to next go over a few things of how we might like to hold ourselves, okay? As a community organizer, help to facilitate groups both big and small, and one of the things that we implement is called norms and agreements. These norms and agreements are very key because in each room is different dynamics. So we are going to come up with some norms and agreements, and we have some already prepared. I really just have one. But these norms and agreements is what we're going to hold ourselves and each other accountable to, so that we can have all of our speakers present and have, most importantly, an hour of community Q&A from you guys. Okay, that's what we want. We want to get there. Okay, so really, we all know that one of the only norms and agreements that I have is aloha kahi ike kahi. Right, love one another. Love one another. If we love one another, besides our differences of opinion, we can move forward. Now, I'd just like to open it up to the group. What is another norms and agreement that we can all hold ourselves to? Feel free to just share popcorn style. That means you just throw it out there. You can shout it out and I'll echo it out. Is there any norms and agreements that we would like to collectively hold ourselves together to make sure that we
be respectful?
Be respectful. Can we agree to being respectful by a clap of hands? Is there another norms and agreement we want to hold ourselves to?
Kapu aloha.
Can we hold ourselves to kapu aloha? Is there any norms and agreements that Anybody else would like to contribute to this group before we move on? Can we please put our cell phones on vibrate or turn them off? Can we all agree to that? Vibrate or turn them off? I know, so busy our life. Put it on vibrate just for us. Yes, sir. Addressing your concern without hateness. Exactly. And I want to mahalo. This is my father, everybody. Apulu Iwani Moma. He's not Kanaka. He's Samoan. We proud. But he's here to learn about it. And so I welcome them. Thank you, Dad. You know, we're good. We're good. All right. With that said, I would like to then go over the agenda right now before I introduce the speakers, our moderator, and our facilitator, and we'll get into our program. You can open. Okay. So each speaker is going to be given 5 minutes to present, 5 minutes to present to the general public, to our community. Okay. After the speaker's presentation, they will then immediately have one question to answer. And these questions have been prepared from our Aha Aloha Aina organizers. Because we helped to put the Hana into this meeting, there are some questions that we want to have to ask directly, okay? After that immediate question, and all the presenters have spoken and presented, and they've answered their questions, our goal is to have an hour of community Q&A, okay? You can know? Just by a round of applause, can we agree to that? Mahalo, mahalo. Whew. Thank you, Nadia. I mahalo you guys for being very patient with us and our organizing crew. This is the first time we've ever done something like this, where we have opened it up to speakers. We've done Aha Aloha Aina. Now with that said, I would like to introduce our speakers at this time. I'm just going to introduce them down the line from this way, from left to right, to from my left to this right. And then I'm going to introduce our moderators, our moderator, and then our facilitator. And then the moderator will take over and they will control the moderation and they'll give the order of the speakers and go on and so forth. You can know? So to my far left here, we have the president of the Sovereign Council of the Hawaiian Homestead Association, or known as SHA, Mrs. Robin Danner. To her right is the president of the Council of Native Hawaiian Advancement, Mrs. Michelle Kauhane. We invited former Governor John Waihehe. He was on it. Not here. and we are. We have asked, and we have been. The invitation was accepted from Namakalehua, which is a group of young Napio organizers. Davis, and a graduate from UH Richardson School of Law, Davis Price. And the invitation was offered to Board of Trustee Peter Apo, and he's not here. And instead, we also offered for invitation to Ziri Aki, who's also part of Namakalehua, and he was a chief drafter of the Naia Puni Constitution. To my immediate right here, we have. Doctor of Philosophy and Indigenous Education. Sorry, very nervous here. My heroes, all the people here, right? From Dr. Ku Kahakala. Hey. To her right, speaking on behalf of Aha Aloha Aina, convener, Dr. Kalama Nihimi. To Kalama's right, good friend of mine, as well as Kia'i, you'll see him, Mauna Awa Kea, Kao Kahi Kanuma. And to our immediate right and far right, international lawyer, expert, speaker in the United Nations, Mrs. Mililani Trask. There's a lot of hana that went into organizing such a diverse and well expert group of speakers. So I want to just mahalo all of our organizers out there that helped this. Big mahalo to you guys. Big mahalo to all the people on the forum. Now at this time, I would like to identify our facilitator. Our facilitator in haole terms is somebody that helps to massage the conversation along, somebody that is well respected within our community that we can all collectively in regards to. I'd like to introduce from Molokai, Uncle Walter Riddy. And finally, our moderator for this evening, he's also a good friend of mine, entrepreneur, longtime advocate for the independence movement, also from right here in Kalihi, Ikai Kohasi.
Aloha. So my understanding is that the organizers were intending for two speakers from each side to speak and then to flip to the other side. So Zuriaki is not available today, but he was supposed to speak first. So Davis, why don't you take his 5 minutes as well as your 5 minutes?
So my name is Davis Price. I see a lot of familiar faces in this room. It was a last minute invitee to fill in. And I believe my capacity, my capacity as a participant, speaking in my capacity as a participant in the Na'i'au Puni'aha held earlier this year. So, little introduction. My ohana is from Hupua, Kali, by way of upcountry Maui, the Kekapa'i Ha'o and Paio Ohana. And I am a graduate, not only of the law school, but of the Hawaiian Studies Kamaku Center, Kamaku Kalani Center for Hawaiian Studies at UH. And it is there that I kind of got my feet wet and kind of got tossed into the activism role alongside of many of the familiar faces I see in this room on numerous issues. It was also there that I recognized my pathway forward, which was to engage in policy. I was always fascinated and always a student of our kingdom history growing up, and always raised a lot of questions about how things played out and the twists and turns that took place in that very tumultuous time. So I continued those studies. And one thing that I recognized my kuleana to be was to take on that policy role that was so critical in shaping the kingdom and our history, the future going forward from there. So what I recognized was that engagement was critical, because I saw what Haoles did within our kingdom. It played a very significant role in policy making that eroded the rights of the native people for a very long time, very quickly. So I said, why can't we flip that on its head and do the same thing today? And then study history more, and you see the labor movement of the
50s and 60s.
Check. Where you had another wave of movement, political engagement from the minorities, the workers, the disenfranchised, the underrepresented, exercising their voice and taking power. And I always questioned Where was Hawaiian's role in all of these things? And there was Hawaiians engaged very much so at every level of this, but for some reason, the masses didn't seem to reap all the benefits. So as a student, I studied, how can we get our people in mass to protect our land? My family was displaced. Unfortunately, a bunch of my great-great-grandfather's daughters married Holly's dad. Essentially swindled all our land from upcountry. Hence why they ended up in Kali. So, how do we change these things, and how do we work with the system and utilize the tools that essentially that's all it is to me? Government is a tool. Whether it be kingdom law, state law, American law, international law, it's all a tool. And the thing that I try to never forget in every step of participation that I engage in is that this is about the people and the Aina. For me, I gotta look past the kingdom history. It's a small window. We have 1,000 years of history prior to that, where the focus was people and Aina. And that is when our people flourished. People were surviving once the Westerners came. When the focus was people and Aina, they flourished. So how do we get back to that focus? How do we get that intertwined in every piece of policy that comes out of whatever government it is we're going to participate in? So that said, I engaged in the AHA, not as a supporter of federation, not as a supporter of independence, but how do we get down to the facts? There's so many mistruths flying around in the air. How do we get down to the facts where people can stop looking at each other as enemies on opposite sides of the battlefield, but to engage with each other? Because unless we galvanize, it's not going to be an answer. It's going to be a very hard road forward. So I went in there thinking, see all these different points of view and see if we can't find one common ground. My experience was, it's not the best process. By far, it was broken. That's another reason why I engaged. And I respect everybody's position, you know, to not participate, to stay outside. Everybody has a role and it should be respected. And all those roles is significant and important. For me, I went inside to try and see where everybody's perspective is coming from. And like I said, to find out if there was a common ground. Because another understanding I had was that something I learned through my schooling, the people that I've spoken with, mentors, experts, was that there is no federal recognition or independence. It doesn't have to be exclusive of each other. It's two frameworks of law: self-determination, indigenous peoples, kingdom law, nationals, separate government. It doesn't have to be exclusive of each other. So why can't we move on the path together simultaneously? And what I found in there was, no one could tell me that I was wrong, that it's one or the other. And I'm not gonna name drop, but significant legal experts, people that are highly respected on both sides, wouldn't give me a clear-cut answer. So, that said, my time up. Oh, you're playing time left. Okay. So that said, again, so to find common ground, and what I found in there was a lot of hope, and that we can have very, very emotional, differing opinions and still come to a common ground and still respect each other's opinions. And that no matter what we choose, there is no clear-cut choice that says, I'm going to shut you out if I go this way, or I'm going to shut you out if I go this way. There is nothing like that. Like I said, government is a tool. Law is fluid, subject to political will. Political will determined by the people. As long as the people move together, can I stop them? Plain and simple. Plain and simple. So all the bashing that goes on back and forth, kingdom guys ignorant, veteran guys sellouts, it's got to stop. And I'm hoping, I participated with the young people in that room to try and I guess set an example from our generation that's kind of tired of that rhetoric, tired of the bashing. Yeah, we want to figure out a way forward. Call us idealistic, call us, but if you talk to us, I think you find out that that's not the case. So, sooner or later, I think this next generation is going to take the reins. And we're going to rock and roll, plain and simple, you know, and we're going to do it together. I stood side by side along other young people, Barakohokahi, staunch kingdom advocate. I don't oppose him. I don't think he opposes me. You know, so it's all about how we're going to forge a path together. And we're not trying to miseducate or diseducate. I think the independence discussions need to keep going. I think the work that's happening in the international arenas need to continue to happen. But that doesn't mean that because someone is working on a different platform or working within the framework of the state or the United States, that they oppose those guys. Or vice versa, it shouldn't be. And so I'll close with that. I think if there's Q&A afterwards, that might be more helpful. But mahalo for having us, and Josh, mahalo for inviting me. Appreciate it.
So the question that I'd like to pose to you, Davis, and this actually might be a question that the three of you might be interested in responding to, is that, you know, we all woke up to a very different world yesterday. And given this brave new world in which we find ourselves, with a president-elect that has already said that he's going to pick, you know, an oil executive to run the Environmental Protection Agency, what are the prospects for processes such as Na'i Aupuni or federal recognition in general, given this incredibly rightward change in U.S. politics?
How long do we have to answer? Can I go past the
I'll ask them too to respond to it.
Check. Quick response. If there's ever been a time that we need to do exactly what I just said, now is the time.
Yes.
Simple as that. Yes. Our natural resources, very much so, are going to be under assault.
Yeah.
Probably more so on the mainland, on the continent than here. At first, I don't know. Who knows where they like drill? But if there's ever been a time that we need to galvanize, raise our voice loud, all Hawaii stand together, is now. Very much so. And I don't think federal recognition, to me, it's putting the cart before the horse. Federal recognition not going to solve the problem. The people going to solve the problem.
My response to that question would be that I have confidence that we are a resilient people. We have been. This is one president. We will have another president and another president. That doesn't change what we fight for to better the conditions for ourselves. So every administration comes with pluses and minuses, as this one will. So we work harder. But I also believe that there is so much work to do here at home first. We don't need to talk about recognition without first having a government. We should focus on standing up the government that must be recognized or could be recognized someday or another. But right now, there is nothing for the federal government to recognize because we have not stood up a Native Hawaiian government.
Robin, I'm gonna come back to you in a minute. Okay. So I'm
taking the mic soon, ku kahakala. There we go.
Aloha nā kua, nā oma kua, aloha mai nā li Hawaii nei, aloha mai nā kupuna me nā makua me ka lehulehu a kua mai nei. Ko waolo ku kahakala o ke ke alopaka kahakala o ke ke awi yama, ke ahunui kahakala o ihanao ia I ke aino ke lihi nei, a ke noho nei wau maku kui hai nei ke manawa. Aloha mai kā kua mai nei back the Ku Kaha Kalau, but I'm better known as Anti-Ku, and that's how I'm gonna address you today and talk about what we believe is what we need to do as Hawaiians, which is simple, to Ku a Kanaka. Ku a Kanaka means to stand as a Hawaiian, to live as a Hawaiian, and to be a Hawaiian. And on a day-to-day basis, it's real simple. You know, we live the values that the Olelo Noeau tell us to live like. We practice our own traditions that we learn from our kumu. We use Hawaiian as the preferred mode of communication if we can. If we cannot, we talk pidgin, that's all right. We perpetuate the mindset of our kupuna as a way of life. Now, what was the mindset of my kupuna? My grandpa, born and raised in Kalihi, he and his parents, they were for independence. In fact, in 1897, 90% of everybody in Hawaii was for independence. Fast forward to 2014, I went to Keaukaha, because I'm from the Big Island, 100% of the Hawaiians there were for independence. So nothing has really changed. However, when you read this palapala that they're supposed to be using to define who we are, they said, oh, there were general comments, both supporting and opposing. Full lie! 100% of the people were against it, and here we get this supporting and opposing stuff. Moreover, this Manawa continues to be misrepresented. I got this letter from Maisie, not that I'm pursuing her or anything, but I got the letter just so happened yesterday from Maisie, and it says the final rule follows extensive, passionate comments. The comments was, do not create a rule. That doesn't follow making what we told them to do. And so the promises are totally hewa and incorrect. They're saying that many Native Hawaiians contend that their community's opportunities to thrive would be significantly bolstered if we became an American tribe. Yeah. And they claim that these formal government-to-government relationships between the Indians and the U.S. government are enormously beneficial to Native Americans. Now let's look at the Native American reality. Poverty has prevailed on preservation. Highest poverty and unemployment rates in the nation. As far as education, which is my kind of background, disproportionately underachieving, dropout rate twice the national average. So, you know, as an educator, what are the benefits of federal recognition? Well, we have two options. First of all, neither these procedures nor NAGPRA mentions one word about education. However, the top 13 countries in the world in education all make sure that in their constitution it talks about the importance of the right of education, because that's how we establish a culture of education where education is valued. And so right now with federal recognition, you have two options. Everything stays the way it does, and education stays under the state. And we know that the Department of Education has failed our 70,000 keiki, and not just this generation, but the one before and the one before, miserably. The other option, Kalamai, go back one more time, would be to create new schools, like Hawaiian versions of DIA schools. And let me tell you, I'm in Indian country. You wouldn't want to attend, for your kids to attend DIA schools. So, but what are the possibilities of independence? And for that now, we need to look at the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, which is an important standard that was set for the treatment of indigenous people. Now that was voted in 2007 by 144 states, but not the United States. So that means they're not in favor of this. And so again, the procedures, zero reference to this most important document for indigenous people, even though it was signed into law by President Obama. Article 3, right to self-determination. Article 4, 8, right not to be forced to assimilate, which is happening right now. And then most importantly for me, right to set up and manage our own schools and education system. That can only happen under independence, not under being under any kind of a federal Indian kind of policy. And so we have a long history of quality education. We had the first public school system west of the Rockies, and we still believe in education. 1997, the Native Hawaiian Education Council calls for the establishment of a Hawaiian system of education. Today, we're working on a ecoversity education with Aloha. We're moving forward, and we're excited about that movement. We're working towards decolonization. The time is now to go into the next steps, which is to resist meaningfully and actively, to create, to restore our practices, and to go back to doing the things that will work for us. Mahalo.
So my question for Dr. Pahakalau is, right now, Native Hawaiian youth, actually, our youth represent a significant percentage of the Department of Education public schools, something like 25 or 26%, with Filipinos being another 25%. What do you think we should be doing now with our current Department of Education system as part of a transition to a sovereign future?
I think we've tried everything we can. Personally, I know I have. I tried to be a good DOE teacher. I tried to have a school within a school. I tried to have a school outside, like a charter school. The reality is the Department of Education is mired in institutionalized racism, and for the first time, they are actually talking about it. So HSDA is talking institutionalized racism, and that needs to stop. You know, we cannot have 9% Japanese teachers and 27% Hawaiian students, but only 9% Japanese students and so little Hawaiian teachers, so that it's totally skewed. So I really think the only thing that will work is for us to create our own system. We're already working on it, and we just need everybody to be part of that. If we 70,000 parents stood up and said, we're not going to send our children to a school anymore that is known to be racist, then they got to do something. And they should give us the $600 million that they spend every year not educating Hawaiian students, and let us educate our own people.
Dr. Nihei.
Can I ask a little favor for folks, just to help the rest of the speakers out? Can somebody get a phone and just put your timer and put it, face it toward the speakers so that they know what the timing down is? That would be great, and that'll be easy for us so that we can actually just glance over to you and know how much time we have left. So Aloha Aina, I'm Dr. Kalama Okaina Niheo. I'm one of the people who are organizing the Aloha Ainas throughout the islands. Next slide. So I think that one of the things that's really, you know, surprised a lot of people was that Trump was elected. Independence people are not surprised. Lot of them realize that what has happened in the past is happening now. It's been happening since the beginning of America has started. They have never done justice by indigenous peoples, and they have never. That right now, they got this, we have a president that is the result of underestimating the American people, and then also underestimating the level of racism that's happening in the nation itself. Next slide. And I wanted to point out that part of it is because the American system is broken. And what they've done is, I'd like to do a little bit of analogy of how they've completely been disconnected from their own people and how it's been propagated to over here. And so one of the things that they did was, in 2011, they created a Kana'i Olubalu Commission. And then what they did was, they didn't ask our community, they just assigned it to them. Because they thought they knew better. Just like, you know how the Democratic National Party thought they knew better and put Hillary in charge? Next. So what they did is, without our consent, they kind of kept on, again, you have in WikiLeaks, you have all these things going on, where Hillary is like swindling the Democratic Convention, right? Then you have here, trying to make things fit rather than actually getting true consent from the people. They rolled over these names, tens of thousands of names from the Kanaiola Vala list over into this role. Next slide. And what they had was, in 2016, 150 unelected Na'iapuni participants created a constitution without really going out into the community. Next. And one of their first acts for the interest of expediency to get this constitution written within 10 days was decide to not allow the community to present the concerns. And as a result, 8 Kanaka were arrested at the gates of this private country club simply for wanting to bring our concerns to the table. And the question is that a nation for our people? And right now what we're looking at is a major land grab. Our analysis is, and we don't all agree with this, but what's the main reason why they want to do this? Why are they pushing it through? If you look at and study First Nations and how they have to spend all this time to get recognized at the DOI, they want to quiet the title. They want to quiet the land title of 1.8 million acres of seized land. And the only land that we have guaranteed right is Koho'olawe. Are we going to live there? Can we live there as a people? Next. And the roles are, this is not anything new. Back a couple of years ago, 2014, OHA itself put out this informational poster that said, if you do not sign up for this role, you threaten the rights of you, yourself, and all your descendants forevermore to be considered a Native Hawaiian. Okay? That's some really intense stuff. Okay, what? We're talking about 80% of our people not on this list. Next slide. So the question then becomes, in a step back a minute, is federal recognition a healthy form of government? As a doctor, I can go for miles about all of the different statistics that show that it has really failed the Native American people. Next slide. But really, for those of you who have been following and paying attention, during an administration that's supposedly friendly to Native Americans compared to what Trump is supposed to be, here we have Standing Rock Sioux standing up for clean drinking water for 12 million people. And this is a response, a militarized response, where they attack unarmed Standing Rock Sioux with over-enthusiastic, like violent, militarized concussion grenades, mace, attack dogs. Next slide. And we're also looking at a president right now who completely denies that climate change is occurring. And this is not just one person. This is a representation of American policy. While this was happening, again, somebody that's supposed to be one of the guys that is pushing for climate change preparation actually signed 3 pipelines through to allow this crude oil to go through the United States. He's not stopping it, he's continuing fossil fuels. Next slide. And the thing is right now, as people don't always really consider this an option. But this is something to think about. And it's not just for us. I show here, Tokelau. There, right now, their islands are going underwater. And they're saying, we are not drowning, we are fighting. And our islands soon may rise, and we need to realize that there is a choice coming right now. And for those of you, as a scientist, as a physician, I am telling you that our people have sustainable resources, sustainable systems in place. Next slide. And what we need to do is, Aloha Aina, next couple slides over, next slide. This, look at all of our different sciences, and one of them is healthy systems of governance. And right now what we have over here, this is the Kalai Moku, our traditional form. This is what we should be basing on. This is our structure on Aloha Aina, and where everybody has a place. And that's what any pathway for. There's one thing I agree with. There's a lot of things to disagree, but if one thing that we definitely all agree on is that we need to come together, we need to unite. This is a very scary time for a lot of people, and we need to do it in a very powerful way, in a real way, in a way that's not false and manufactured, in a way that honors the work of every single person here. Mahalo.
hard question to you, which is the federal recognition process is more or less well understood. What is the complementary process for independence?
Well, I think that there's I wish I had known I had that question. I have a really great infographic flowchart of independence that it's relatively complicated, but everybody sees it as like, oh, it's like everyone's like, what's the plan? It's like, we got a plan. And part of that plan, though, fundamentally, if you look at the United Nations, we definitely consult them about this process, and they said any government at its fundamental basis needs to start with building unity and education within the community. And that is what we're doing right now. Aloha Aina is going out without any state and federal monies. We are going out to the community and actually listening to them. You know, we don't always agree with some of the things that they're asking for. We're having a challenging time, okay? What happened when we had the Halabais out there to educate people about what was happening with Na'iapuni? Because they weren't doing it. With all their millions of dollars, they didn't go out into our communities. So us, with zero budget, with only the aloha of our community, went out and we listened to the people. And they said, we need an aloha for our people. And we're like, gosh, we're broke. All of us up here are broke. What are we gonna do? We can't afford to have 2 weeks and, you know, even a month where we get together. So, you know, we went to every community and said, any community out there that wants to be a part of this aloha, organizing your community will go to you and we will come with you and we will listen to you. And out of that came this. Not everybody in Aloha Aina is very excited about including everybody's voices here, but we are here because we need to start talking. There's one thing that we need to do is we need to start talking to each other. And there's a lot of guns pointing back and forth. Arrows and, you know, rubber bullets going back and forth. We feel like it's North Dakota again. I just came back from North Dakota. I was like, oh my God, it's like, you know. But that's the first thing that has to happen. The next thing is moving along is that we need to build international alliances. We need to go and we have to recognize first that we are an independent country and that we have leveraging that we can utilize throughout the world. That there are a lot of people throughout the world that really want to have a neutral country here rather than a military giant. And the other thing that I didn't really point out before, I've never really answered this question directly, but Rome fell from within. Empires rise and fall. Part of the plan is understanding that the United States have proven and they're showing that they are unable to care for even their own population. So it's time for the peoples throughout the world to unite in caring for the people where they are and to move away from this global domination that has been happening and has dominated and destroyed the planet. We need to move forward to a new future.
Don't tell Donald Trump that stuff about Rome, he's not gonna like it. So, for our next speaker, I just wanted to give some respect to Robin Danner, because we haven't always agreed, and I think there's a lot of folks on both sides of these tables that have not agreed for many years, and it takes a lot of courage and aloha for your people to come to this kind of event. So I want to say thank you personally for your time. So Robin, you're up.
Am I answering the original question, or what did you want me to do?
Or just give your own presentation.
Oh, we have the presentation. Aloha, everybody.
Aloha.
My name is Robin Danner. I was born on the island of Kauai. Grew up in Numalu, a little fishing village where my mom and her 12 brothers and sisters grew up. I was raised fishing, and then my parents were teachers, and I spent a lot of time on the Indian reservations of the Navajo, the Hopi, the Apache, in their educational systems, and my parents were then part of the self-determination movement of the indigenous people of Alaska to free themselves from the Bureau of Indian Affairs educational system. So Ku, you might be speaking of it, but I actually witnessed the breaking down of a BIA school and the self-determination of a Native people, and my mother as a Native Hawaiian wanted to be a part of that, and they opened the first non-BIA high school and elementary school in rural Alaska to break the bonds of wardship, and for the last 40 years have operated their own education. So I don't think that our situation is different. I think we all have different experiences. I'm a banker by training. I want to congratulate the organizers, especially Haleni and Shane and others, for this gathering. I mean, when I saw the materials presented and just the logistics of everything, I want to congratulate you on a job well done for tonight. It actually reminded me of about 20 years ago when we were all part of, and still part of, Kalahui. And when Kalahui raised money from the federal government through the A&A program and funded hundreds of workshops under the leadership of Millie Lunny, when we worked together, and then when I met Haleni and Shane was about almost 20 years ago. They came on board with Kalahui, and we worked on Project Hawaiian Justice, which was a Kalahui initiative to understand and put forward one of the three rings of sovereignty that we learned so well through the Kalahui work from the 1980s. I didn't get started till 1993, which was about federal acknowledgement, federal recognition. What I want to respond to is that we have got to stop mischaracterizations. We need to be in control of our own education. We need to be in control of our own businesses. We need to grow Native-controlled businesses, our educational schools. The charter school movement and the indigenous education has been wildly successful. But the Native Hawaiian Education Council, for example, that Crew spoke about, was not formed by the Kingdom of Hawaii, was not formed by the state of Hawaii. It was legislated by the federal government, the Native Hawaiian Education Act. So my message with that is that we cannot be all for and all against. We as Hawaiians, given our history, given where our children are, given where our spouses are, given where incarceration is, we must take every tool. We must not deny ourselves, our elders, or the next generation of millennials any tool, whether that is a state tool, a federal tool, or an international tool. That is the reality. And what I have come here to tell you is that very strongly, one of the mistakes we are making because it's sexy, because it's easier, is that we think it's independence or a Native government to government relationship with the United States. And we have got to stop selling that snake oil. It is not one or the other. It is both. No Hawaiian should be opposed to independence. It's in our DNA. And that is a pathway that must be traveled, traversed consistently. And it will take many generations. Because until the global power changes, and the United States is no longer in charge of the UN, you can worship the UN, but that is the United States today. They are on the Security Council, they have veto power. That is the reality we live in today. So we keep the fire burning and the work that is being done on the international level, just as Indian people are doing. And we must grab hold of every tool. And federal recognition, again, is not a healthy government, young lady. Federal recognition is not a government. It is not a form of government. It is a relationship. The government is what we may choose. And so my message to our people is stop the mischaracterizations just because it's fun and it's sexy and it's cool to be Malcolm X for 5 minutes. We got to do the hard work of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, both of them. Our unborn deserve our best minds, our best debates. And I tell you, coming from someone who has been demonized in front of my grandchildren, who has been demonized when I have Kanaka boys, we have got to stop it. So I am here to say, I love my people. I am Kanaka, and I will never disrespect another Kanaka that has a better idea or even a worse idea. I celebrate all of us, and I call on my brothers and sisters that are working hard at the front lines of independence. AO, you must do that. And I celebrate those that must work who brought the Native Hawaiian Education Act, who brought the Native Hawaiian Housing Block Grant through the federal system. Do not deny my children or my kupuna or my neighbors from affordable housing because we have a bone to pick about the global reality of the United States. It is neither evil nor a saint. You know this. And the final thing I have to say, on behalf of my family, on behalf of my nieces and nephews and my kupuna that are not only Native Hawaiian, but that are Native American, I am tired of the mischaracterization of people discussing Indian issues of which you know nothing about. Federal recognition is not the cause of the terrible poverty, the alcoholism that plagues Indian country. It is no more the cause of that than it is the cause of our own abuse of alcohol and drugs. We don't even have federal recognition, so we can't blame federal recognition. In fact, if you know your history, and I'm sorry, when you know your history, American Indians suffered over 500 years of forced assimilation, of brutal murder, not even comparable to our own experience. So have a little respect. When I hear people say, I'm not an Indian, that tells me I'm speaking to someone that doesn't know that there are no Indians, does not know that the Navajo are not Indian, they are Navajo. The Comanche are not Indian, they are Comanche. Kanaka are Kanaka. Indian is a term of art, and to flip that word around as if it's offensive is offensive to me, and I think we as Kanaka need to go back to our people, go back to the ways of our kupuna, that we do not disrespect another just because it makes us feel better or bigger. So on behalf of my nieces and nephews, some of which who have left their own aina because of some of you, 20-year-old, 18-year-old, that is not the people of my mother. And I think that I call on the kingdom, I call on the royal order here and now to implement what our elite created you for, protocol, proper behavior. I want our people on both sides to align with protocol. And my last closing is to make sure it's very clear. I am for a Native-only government that is recognized by the state of Hawaii, the county of Kauai, the county of Maui, that is recognized by the United States of America, that is recognized by New Zealand, by the European Union, and so on. I am for a Native-only government that is recognized by the United States, okay? That is a Native-only government. I am for the governance my people had before the short-lived term of the kingdom. We had 2,000 years of Native-only sovereignty and governance. Number two, I am for independence of Hawaiian nationals, Native and non-Native. Those are two things. So I am for Native governance and I am for independence.
You don't speak for me.
Okay, thank you. So Mahalo Nui, I am for, I am not against. I am pro federal recognition and I am pro Hawaiian independence. Mahalo.
Michelle, why don't you go on with the presentation?
So Michelle Kauhani with the Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement, and first and foremost, I just want to share about what CNHA is, because I see lots of things about what we are and what we're not. And so we are a Native Hawaiian nonprofit of over 150 members locally here in the state and nationally. I see the time. CNHA is 15 years old. We have been gathering. I heard Aha Aloha Aina talk about 30 gatherings. We have been gathering in our community for 15 years. We have been holding forums, educational symposiums, summits, and hold an annual Native Hawaiian convention, and have done so since our inception. We just celebrated last month our 15th annual Native Hawaiian convention. So when I hear people say, you don't speak for me, I don't. I don't speak for you, but I have a membership that I'm accountable for. You don't speak for me, and I don't speak for you. But we definitely convene our community, we speak to our members. Do all of our members support federal recognition? No. Skippy Iwane sits on my board. We have great debates, but he continues to come to my board. We work on housing. We work on Native Hawaiian education. We work on things that we can agree on. He does not agree with federal recognition, but he has not yet quit the board. He just re-upped for another term. But we are unembarrassed, we are unapologetic for being supporters of federal recognition. That did your DOI hearings have a lot of opposition? Absolutely. Because we stayed home. We stayed out of that chaos where when we stood up, we got booed. Where my husband stood outside the cafeteria at Makakilo because he was watching on television and knew I was coming up and said, holy crap, I let her go there by herself. So we submitted 5,124 comments, actually answering the questions that the DOI was asking. And so when you get frustrated about whether they heard your voice or not, you have to answer the question being posed. The question was not whether or not you supported federal recognition. The question was, if you organize yourselves as a government, Hawaiians, how shall we, the federal government, know that it is you, the government that we should be recognizing? And we didn't really answer that question verbally. We said, go home, get out of here, a'ole DOI. We didn't answer the question. And so, yes, we have supported federal recognition. We will continue to support federal recognition. Some people agree with Kana'i Oluwalu, some people don't. Some people have a bad taste in their mouth that the names got transferred. It's like any other vote. If you don't want to show up and cast your vote to ratify that constitution, you don't need to. But some of us want federal recognition. Not recognition that says, I am Hawaiian. Recognition that the government says, we recognize you as a government. There are lots of things that we want that are the same. But right now, the work that CNHA is focused on is really about ratification of the document. If you don't like the draft constitution, vote it down. The constitution doesn't guarantee federal recognition. The constitution lays forward before you to decide on a unicameral democracy. That is the form of government. The constitution does not say federal recognition. That is a relationship, as Robin explained. The draft constitution that will come before our people really asks you, do you support the unicameral democracy that is laid out in that document? It doesn't ask you federal recognition or independence. That is a relationship that your government may choose to have, but first we have to stand up that government. And so CNHA right now will continue to focus on education so that we, in hopes of getting to some kind of understanding, will our people vote that up or down? And if we vote it down, then we start again. But that is where we're at. I want to be clear about CNHA's position. I have 4 seconds, so I'm going to end there and take your question.
So my question is for the individuals who have decided not to participate thus far in this process, if we were to project 20 or 30 years down the line, what do you think happens to them and to their cake?
That's not up to me. That will be up to the government once we stand that up. That is not, that's not my answer to give to you. But right now, participation is up to the individual. We chose to participate in the process. We wanted to participate. Those that didn't want to, aole pilikia. I support federal recognition, and I have not opposed, as Robin shared, supporters of federal recognition have been villainized as traitors, as corporate whores. But you crossed the line when you included my child. That is off limits. Right? So it's...
Well, the question though was, if people, if there are Hawaiians that don't want to participate in the Na'ialpuni, in the Constitution, in the ratification, is that your question? And what about those that don't?
But let's get back to your answer after, if you may. We still have two more presentations, Moho'okahi and Mililani. Moho'okahi, your office.
He keiki vau I a'o'a'o ia I pula ia ma ko'olalo Hawaii. Keiki papahana vau ko punana leo. Komo vau ma papa mua loa ko punana leo kone ka maka iki ui kumei makane ka kumaha. A leila, puka mai leila ko omau aku I ke kula kai apuni. O e hunui kai malino I a manawa ke kula kai apuni Hawaii ka kona. I ka papa e ono. A leila maape mai lele aku vau I o ahu I kalihine I ka palama. Hele kula nui ma, hele ki kula ma kamehameha. Puka vau ma kumaka iki e lua kaukani e hiku, mai ke kula o kamehameha ma kapalama. Ho ma wapu ke kula nui o manua, lua ka upalapala ma leila no ka olelo Hawaii. O vau, yeah, ka ko'o ana vau I keia mea o ka imi ana I keia. Walao wa walao ia ka kia oa o ke ka hele kula ana a me ke ea maloko ke la o vau hele wai kukuna na leo kona maka iki umi kumai wa kanei kumaha ma ia manawa aale loa ke kahi kula kai a puni mahape aku ea mahape puna na leo kuka pau hoi oi na muhaole hoi oi a hao ika Star Spangled Banner a pela aku aale kou mau makuai ai ke la aale kou mau makuai ai ke la Puka vau me ka punana leo, ko ole lako I ka ho'ona ni yau I ke kula au puni, papu malao. Aale, noho ai ma ke kula kamali'i, ko o mau kia oana ma ka olelo Hawaii. A pau ka ma kou hana, a loa ka o kula, e hele ai. A no lele imi lako, imi lako, imi lako, imi noke, noke, imi noke, kulia, a he vā I pau ai. A leila, loa ka vā, e hele kula vau, ma ke kula kai au puni. Vehe ia hamama ke kahi pula. A'o ia vau maka olelo Hawaii. A'o ke la kanu ia pa'u hele kula ana. Mai ke kula kamali'i ai ka papa eono. Ale vau olelo Hawaii maka meha mea oe ale ai ia ma ke la va. Ko'u komo ana maka papa olelo Hawaii. Ka kula ki e ki e ai ia. Olelo Hawaii. Kula nui olelo Hawaii. O ka uhana he kumu vau maka punana leo no eiva maka hiki olelo Hawaii. No leila ka hapunio ko uola he olelo Hawaii wale no. Maloko ka olelo Hawaii no ake kai ano kuana ike. Ho paa ia kukuru ia ko u kuana ike mao ko u olelo. No leila, o ke ano o ko u noo noo ana, o ke ano o ka u mauhana, o ko u kuana ma mauna kea pelaku. He ho pena ke la o ke a oana I ko u olelo. He ho pena ke la o ke a oa o ia Ma ke kahi ano I kokoke I ke ano I kiau, I ke ano I a'o ia I koka puma kupuna. A'ale like loa. A'ale loa like. A ka maloko o ke la, lo aka hua lo aka hua aka ale pau mali no leila no oye ke ano ale ka pau noi ale ka pau kali ha avi mai kai pala pala aye ke e ma nei maloko ka pau ma nei ma nei aina ahe e ma nei ale ku oko a ma nei me ole ka pala pala me ole ka ole lo tika ikana ka ike ma pau ya hoi pon kapo iki apa pu iho no leila ea oye ko make make oba u bako ka u ke wana ba ho iho i mai aka ike le aba mak mana dali ke a ale mako ka ka ko a ale no kapo ke la he ba no ko me ho amerika ia ka ko pa ka ia pa ina ale kapo ole lo vai ho amerika ia maroko ko ole lo vai ia ho amerika nui ia ba aka lo ake kahi ka hua ke kahi a o ke ano ko u ka hua wo like no me ke ali a a he me na nai kula ya a he me na nai ka wahi ke ka hua wo e he wo malu wo pa a imi ana e imi ana a a he vai pa wai ka imi no leila ale ka ko imi ke ala ma ala ni ale ka ko imi ke ala viki viki no ko mea wo vai ni mo ia ke ala ya vai na nei vai mo ke ala ma pe mai ma ko na ko ki wo ho ike ko ka ko mo ku pune ya ka ko ike ala e hele ai ho hele ko ba vai hele ka ko
so ko wo ni na ya ho e no ko po e I I'll do it in English. Do you favor an education system for Hawaii ke manawa, in which everyone would learn a lot of Hawaii?
Hey! No ko mea.
Wait. What you say? Now tell me in English.
Ale lawa ko manawa. And ale wahana ke ia no ka
pana. Hey,
I'm not doing this to be disrespectful.
Talk to me, Nina.
Akai na imi na kapu I ke ea.
I don't know what the hell you say.
Oye ka pili kia. Oye ke kulana o kapo. Kono e ho'opono pono poke ia ke la. Kono e ho'opono pono poke ia ke la.
What the hell are you talking about?
Please.
No leila. Imi na kapu I ke ea. He ha avina ke ia. He ha avina ke ia. Ku e ana ke kai ko o lelo hawai ana ma hawai ke imi ana kapu I ke e ana hawai e piri kia ke la a oe ki kula na kapu ko e ale no kapu ka hewa a ka pono e ko ona a wau I a kapu a pa ko o wau I ke a oa no ke la me kia po e ko o lelo hawai a ka mea o ka o lelo ke ka a o ka mauli o e ka mea ho o pa ani a kapu a e li me ka u o ewe o maru o pa a he mihi ke ia a ka o ko u pono ke ia o ko ka pou pono ke ia Ale I pau.
Me ka awi. The synopsis of what was said was that ka ho'okahi and many others who were schooled in our schools that were based in our language and our culture. This is a demonstration of the great divide that could potentially continue to be that divide or to turn around and be that which unites us. And so the crux of what was said is that we have a new and younger generation that has been armed and prepared with all the very basic fundamentals, the rudimentary understandings of what it means to be Kanaka from our own language perspective, and therefore, with no disrespect to any of our people who are not fluent in our mother tongue, but merely serving as an example, it is from this foundation, and it is from this, not only a place of a mind, but a heart and spirit, that our next generations base not only the understandings, but the arguments and that which our young generation will advocate for. And that is as short and sweet as I can keep it. He has said that our young people are now, we have done this. Those of us, all of us in this room who have supported Hawaiian education, we have all supported our next generation to be very, very different from that which our Hawaiians who have become very, very comfortable and very assimilated within to the American way of life through no fault of our own. But this is what we are now faced with. This is actually our greatest resource, and that is our future generation.
Lenny Trask.
Aloha, everyone. Aloha, I want to thank those who are putting this together and also our ohanas from the Papakolea for making this mea'ai for us. Thank you so much. I wanted to start by asking for those in this room who are Hawaiian, well, every Hawaiian in this room that read the 172-page DOI rule, raise your hand. And those who did not, you wonder how it could have gotten this far, that it is being implemented in Washington, D.C., without the involvement of our people or the education. The good news is that yesterday, President-elect Trump put a hold on all federal positions from Sally Jewell all the way down to Mr. Stanford Enomoto, who will not be in charge of the Office of Hawaiian Nation. I never thought I would be glad to say anything about President-elect Trump, but I believe that Trump has trumped the DOI rule, and it will be DOA rather than DOI. There's no way we can go through 172 pages in 5 minutes. What I wanted to say was just a few points, 4 points. Number one, why are we talking about a federal rule for federal recognition? What is the purpose of this thing? It didn't come from Hawaii, it came down a few years ago. Well, if you didn't read the 172 pages, you might miss what's on page 59,114. If you read page 59,114, it tells you why we're doing this. We're doing this because some Hawaiians want to exercise inherent sovereign powers so that they can, quote, facilitate the implementation of programs and services that Congress creates specifically to benefit Native Hawaiians. The purpose of the rule is not to give to our people self-determination, but to facilitate the ability of a few to gain sole control of the congressional funding and programs. Read what is in the paper, because what you're being told is not the truth. Point number two, this process.
We can't hear.
Point number two, this process does not give our people the right of self-determination under international law. The right of self-determination is the right of all peoples, with an S. It's a collective right of Hawaiians to determine our political status. What shall be the nation that we shall create, that we shall be citizens of? And by virtue of that right to freely pursue our cultural, economic, and social development, our ability to develop our own economic system, to lay taxes, to raise revenues, to tax others who work on our land, to build housing, to build clinics, to put up schools. This is the definition of social development. What is the purpose of this? The purpose is to facilitate receiving government programs from the Congress, not to allow us to form a nation. Point number three. This is not federal recognition under the current federal policy. If you go back and look up President Ronald Reagan, federal recognition of self-determination, you'll find the statement that President Reagan, a Republican, put on the record. Reagan came out and said, it's time for America to stop treating Indians like wards. It's time to give them their trust lands and empower them so that they can manage their own affairs, return to them their lands, territories, and resources. This is an excuse being called federal recognition, but if you read the 172 pages, you'll see that it says that the Hawaiian Nation will never have any trust lands. All trust lands held by the state remain with the state. All those held by the federal government remain with the federal government. The only exception for the Hawaiian Nation is Koho'olawe, the bombing target, littered with live bombs, no homes, no clinics, no schools for our children. That is what it says. But you didn't have the chance to read it, and no one pushing it is going to explain it to you. The Indian nations have powers the Hawaiian nations will never have. If you read the jurisdictional statutes of the United States, it says that when American Indians and their governments wish to challenge the United States, they go to the federal district court and the United States must respond. Well, if you read what they're saying for our nation, you can try to sue the federal government, but the federal government has sovereign immunity, so they don't have to answer. That is not federal recognition that the American Indians have, not that we are Indians. One of the things that greatly concerns me is that this process requires that we relinquish our claims from the overthrow of our independent kingdom, that we relinquish it. We will never be able to retain back what was taken. And I'm very concerned with the deliberate program of misinformation coming from people like Zuriaki saying that there is no human right to restitution. This is a lie, a lie. Leave me alone. In 1997, the United Nations expert and special rapporteur on the human right of restitution wrote a report telling us what our right was. And 3 years later, the United Nations Committee to Eliminate Racial Discrimination, a binding treaty on the United States, issued this statement. The committee urges all states, including America, to recognize and protect the rights of indigenous peoples to own, develop, control, and use their communal lands, territories, and resources. Where they are deprived of their lands, territories traditionally owned or otherwise inhabited, to return to them their lands and territories. And only when this is not possible for factual reasons should the right of restitution be substituted with the right of compensation. And upon that occurring, compensation shall be paid in the form of land and territories. We have a right to be restored. Our country, our nation, our right to be self-governed. These are our human rights. America didn't like it. This we passed in 1997. The declaration passed in 2007. America refused to sign. 2008, America came to the CERT committee and said, we will not obey the declaration. It's not a binding treaty. And America didn't sign it. America doesn't recognize Hawaiians, only Indians. And the CERT committee said back to America, we note your comment. We decide, however, to use this law to interpret your American binding human rights treaties. So you see, America was struck down in 2008. This we must oppose, election or not. We're going to oppose this. But I believe that President-elect Donald Trump will do this for us. And already I have sent to President-elect Donald Trump a request to ensure that we do not have Mr. Stanford Enomoto taking over the Office of Hawaiian Relations. Nation building, I believe in it. If you want to see a real constitution written by Hawaiians, after 53 workshops, four times, 212 workshops. Look at the Constitution of Kalahui, Hawaii. We didn't forget education and housing like they did over there. This is a federal ruse. We need to oppose it. And thank Akua Mahalo Ke Akua that Donald Trump is here. I can tell you he will not allow this one to proceed and be the shoe.
Jumpers.
So on the CRB ZAF 540. Okay. So I believe we're going to have this microphone is available for people to line up and ask questions to the panel. But why don't we start off with Waupulo Aina. Rahit, I'd like you to respond to the question about Donald Trump and the right wing swerve in U.S. politics.
So the question was, what impact is Donald Trump?
Is federal recognition dead?
Okay. What? Oh, is federal recognition dead? Oh. All right. Thank you. That's a great question, and it should be answered because there seems to be some misunderstanding. The federal rules promulgated by the Department of Interior were promulgated for the federal government to be their rules, number one. Number two, it took 3 years of public hearings, public comments, the record open, 3 years to do 172 pages. In September earlier this year, those rules were adopted. So, the election of the president has no impact, no bearing on the DOI process. It's POW. In other words, what's there is a federal regulation that is written in Part 50, CFR, Code of Federal Regulations 43. There is nothing for President Obama, and there is nothing for President-elect Trump to do. It's done. It was a three-year process. It exists. It sits there in the CFR and does not have to be accessed until Native Hawaiians, until our people want to establish a native government, operate as a government, never even use the process. So I think there's some misnomer that federal recognition, the federal rules under the Department of Interior are not a land claims settlement. There better not be any mention of land or deciding what lands will be there. The federal process was merely a process for the federal government itself to have regulations that it follows, not that we follow, but that it follows in order to extend acknowledgement to a Native Hawaiian-only government. And so that process, Itaika, was approved. The final regulation is in place. It will now sit there. It is not waiting for any federal action. It is not waiting for President Trump to do anything or for President Obama to do anything.
It's dead in the water.
Okay. Yeah, first question.
Still working.
Okay.
Hello? Hello, Akaku.
Aloha.
I am Kumu Ali, Moinui, Kamehameha. My English name is Lancelot Ha'ili Miki. I descend from Nonei Kamakaiki, Eliki, Yawe, Kalaniopu, Kekuaopio. This is why I take this title of Kamehameha. Nana, no disrespect to you, but you should stick to banking. You sound like an attorney over there. How many attorneys do we have in this house, Hawaiian attorneys?
Wait, I need to pause. We said earlier that part of our rules of engagement for tonight is that we would be respectful to each other. So ad hominem attacks are not allowed. Please continue.
I've been respectful. How many attorneys? Can you please do me a favor if you're an attorney? Can you please write a letter to Mr. Trump and asking for redress for my kingdom and our people. Redress, very important word, very, very strong word that covers it all. Money, land, everything, the kingdom come back to us. That's all you need to do. Simple, mathematics. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Aloha. This is for the federal recognition panel. In the federal recognition, if it passes, does the people of Hawaii acquiesce all of their sovereign rights to the U.S. in silent agreement? And what would that hold to our people if it happens to be acquiesced to the U.S.?
The question has never been posed before a court. My interpretation is no. And here's why. You have 125 approximately acts of Congress that have benefited Native Hawaiians. Benefit, or however you want to characterize it, served Native Hawaiians. You have homesteaders, you have 20,000 people on a homestead wait list, Act of Congress. It's not getting to driver's license, paying taxes, and all those things. But just that alone, just Hawaiian programs that Hawaiians participated in. If we were ever to admit or say that that is acquiescence, the majority of our people have acquiesced. So, in my perception, no, it's all been under duress. And I think we have, if there's ever a court that's gonna take that question, I think we have a solid argument. And no one's ever told me no. Professor William St. Chang, international law expert, I posed that same exact question for him at the OHA, at the AHA, multiple times. He told me, he never gave me a clear answer, publicly. So privately, he told me no.
It's a gray area. Okay.
He told me no. Legal experts have told me no.
So one of the clarifying things, I think it's a great question, but one of the clarifying points, once again, that we have to frame is that there are two processes. So when you say acquiesce, the question really is, I'm a homesteader, as Davis said, any scholarships that were taken under the Native Hawaiian Education Act, is that acquiescence? No. And then we have to remember the two. So the question you're asking really comes down to this. If you, does the federal recognition, a nation-to-nation relationship domestically, not internationally, impact any opportunities we have on the international arena, which is a very separate path, and which is why I can say to you, I support both. I don't need to oppose one to do the other. So to answer your question, the answer is no.
Okay, I'd like a response please from this side.
We have, I guess, we have two responses over there, and then we'll have two responses up here. So I'll just start off with one, and that is that when we're talking about acquiescing, we have never said plebiscite or referendum. This is recognized. Ever said that we will go under the plenary power of the United States. Plenary is absolute. Absolute. By participating in this process, is by saying that we're going to be part of this process, we're agreeing to go under the United States. We've never, our people have never, ever agreed to this. We have never as a people ever done that. And internationally and also morally, ethically, we stand behind the fact that our people have never acquiesced. We have never given up. We have never yielded our lands. We have never yielded our lands. And when you take a look, at we have consulted the United Nations, and they look at the process, a couple things happen. When you look at a nation, really truly international recognition, you can't have just one race. That's a violation of the human rights. There have been countries that have tried to do this before, and they're not allowed for very good reason. But you can go to look at the wrong party. And the wrong party are the people who were affected by the overthrow. And those are descendants of the Kingdom of Hawaii. And those are all the Kanaka, but there are also non-Kanaka as well. So that qualifies. That qualifies. So there is, we might disagree on the analysis of this, but we do know Native Americans. We're not the only people that, I won't pretend I'm the only person that knows, has extensive experience with Native American struggles. Because we have learned and walked together side by side because our struggles have been the same. Really, Bonnie here can share thousands of stories as well. I have been raised internationally supporting and fighting for others than side by side with indigenous people. So yes, we do understand this. Mahalo.
I think one thing we got here is America will proceed with you or without you. This is something that was fashioned by a few in Washington and imposed here with public hearings. Even the state legislature law said register 200,000. They spent $7 million in FOHA, registered less than 20,000. And Mr. Price is saying he doesn't know any court that said that. But when the judicial watch took them to the district court in Honolulu, the Na'iapuni disincorporated themselves. Then they went ahead, threw out the roll of 20,000. They never registered 20,000. They threw out the roll of people and said that they're going to write their own constitution without being elected by the people. What the rule says is that America is going to recognize only one nation under their rule. This is the rule. And once that nation gets recognized, they get all the pala from Congress. Congress will never recognize again another Hawaiian nation. This is in the DOI rule. So acquiesce.
Ever.
Do you have to sign up on any other various role commissions like Kanai Olu'olu to vote no against the Na'iapuni Constitution? Do you have to sign up for any other roles to vote no against the Na'iapuni Constitution?
Actually, the constitution that was crafted left it open to be determined. I don't have a language in front of me, but I thought it's you from here. It was left very broad, the language, as far as how the registration would take place, but it was very clear that all Hawaiians would be eligible to vote. It didn't specify any specific registration process, and that was something that many of us went in there to fight for, so that we could make it broader than the previous Kanaka Olu'olu role, because we understood that that was limited, and we heard many people say why that was problematic. So we wanted to open up other options for people to register. For example, one idea that came up, and nothing's been clear cut yet, nothing's been decided yet, was if you ever registered for any Hawaiian scholarship, commemorative schools, my homeland, FOHA, Aruike, whatever you have to do, Hawaiian ancestry, you can bring your documentation and go vote at a polling place. That was something I was being allocated for. Again, not decided. But that's the type of voices that was in that room. No, it's undecided.
It's undecided.
It's open. You may not have to. Hopefully not, in my opinion.
So you guys don't know yet? Are you guys gonna come to that conclusion? Or is it just, we don't know?
It's gonna, hopefully be decided soon. You know, I will have to agree with Dr. Trask, that I feel like the federal recognition process and this nation building process that's been established is stalled. Yeah, but it's separate from the nation building process of just our people coming together and discussing like this how we're going to move forward and how we can build on that constitution, or in my opinion, even the Kalahui constitution, which was incorporated.
The way,
I'll
give you a chance to respond.
The Kalahui Constitution was written by elected representatives of
my peoples. It was copyrighted, as well known, because our Kupuna advised us, the one that's right here, black people only, that the time would come when there would be pro-federal Hawaiians who would try to take the Constitution and manipulate it into something else. You will never have the Palawi Constitution. If you do an educational process and bring designated representatives from the community, you will have a good constitution that will have many things that Palawis have in it. But you cannot designate those from Oa, Nayakuni, the Shah, and CNAJ to lock themselves in the room and come out with a decent constitution. That's as Kuhukam Palawis pointed out. You guys put the constitution in, not about educating the children. You never think about that, yeah?
So it's a difference with indigenous. We are not indigenous. Kawikioli established us as aboriginal, which is Kanaka Maoli. And we were recognized as an international country, independent and sovereign. So you cannot use their words because they forget to tell you what they're asking for. They're asking for domestic recognition. People use the words colonization. We are not colonized. We cannot be because we are recognized as an independent nation among the European nations. So we cannot use that word. There are many words that they throw out. You have to step out of that U.S. box and speak up as a Hawaiian Kingdom subject, which I knew as a child when I was cognizant about things going on from age 8. That's been over, what, 60 years, 70? Who knows? I'm not counting anymore. But the thing to remember is that you have to know who you are. You have to speak as an equal to the United States, not follow their manifest destiny doctrines, which they are imposing upon us. And so there's nothing wrong with those who want to be foreign Americans. But when you go into the Federal Recognition Program, which we all know from the Apopka Bill, you cannot negotiate anything from the Hawaiian Kingdom. So you being Hawaiian Kingdom subjects, you must first renounce your citizenship to the Hawaiian Kingdom and formally naturalize to the United States to join that little tribe. And I think it should be mandated.
So you're going to have some questions that were put up online. We have some people asking questions from Twitter and via email. So Josh is going to ask some of those questions.
There's a question that came in from our hashtag AAA Forum 2016. In the wake of White America's apparent repudiation of religious, sexual, and cultural tolerance in this election, Do you feel comfortable committing a continued, dependent, and acquiescent relationship with the United States? This is for Robin Dan. In the wake of white America's apparent repudiation of ethnic, religious, and sexual and cultural tolerance in this election, do you feel comfortable committing our lahui to a continued, dependent, and acquiescent relationship with the United States?
Well, first of all, no one is committing our lahui to anything. There are many initiatives, there are many different Kingdom organizations, there, you know, we were part of Oahu, there were many Amas. So that's first and foremost. But I think the heart of the person's question is with the recent election. My question back to you would be, with the recent election and the descriptions of the adjectives of what that election means to some folks in terms of using the term racist, et cetera, it was a tough election. But my question would be back to you, what does that mean? Acquiesce? Does that mean I should pull my youngest son out of school? Do I turn in my driver's license? Do I, you know, these kind of things. That's the kind of question that is. And we live in the real world. Tomorrow, many of us are going to go to work. We're going to get in a car and drive it. We're going to take our kids to school. etc. So the recent election doesn't make cause us to do anything different. That is to be in a mind frame that someone else decides what we are doing. So the Trump-Clinton election doesn't freak me out. It's not going to change where my son's going to go to school, where my grandson is going to go to school. It doesn't change how I get there. So I'm not acquiescing to anything because of that election or any other election. There have been 45 presidents in the United States, and it hasn't caused any of us, and certainly not our Wahoo, to acquiesce to anything.
Do I have any other comments from the other side? Any comments? Another question?
For us as a team, already dealing with PTSD. And that's really when I was in the National Guard, PTSD was a big thing. Nobody recognized it back then. I worked with a lot of people in Pennsylvania for Pennsylvania veterans. And a lot of them had no place to go. So, and when I came home, they still had these problems here with our own white veterans. So it's not unique to Native Hawaiians, but it is something that has to be addressed. So where does the loyalty for this form, and how does it hinder independence in any way for the recognition?
Any side want to answer that?
I think the question is, how does federal recognition hinder independence? So that would be a question for Alon. That was your question at the end of explanation.
So basically, when you look at what is the number one thing that defines a people as a nation, and that is land. It's land. You know, if you have a nation that has no land, but we have given it to, that document says
federal, state lands are off the table. We've never given them our lands, and that's what would happen.
I honor every single veteran. My father is a veteran. He fought on both sides of this war. He was a veteran for the United States, and he was a veteran for our Kanaka Maoli people. And that does not invalidate the slavery either situation. But if you take our land, that is the one thing.
This extinguishes title to our land. We have never given up. Right now, things are being held in the courts all over the place. We have that 20% going to Aloha. We have never, ever yielded that. And that is something that is hotly contested. And that's the reason why this got fast-tracked. There was federal recognition takes so long. 2014 to 2016.
You ask any
Native American who is currently going through the process, it has never happened so fast. And why is that? We need to ask ourselves why. And Standing Rock is a great example. Do they care about our indigenous people? And we know that they don't. So why would they do that for Hawaii? Because they love us so much? Because they've taken care of us so well? They want for a reason. Disagree with my analysis, but you have to ask questions.
I know where you're at.
We need to clarify that.
Question for Stanley. Just think of the nature of the question. I like response. He asked a question that hits home deeply. Yeah. In Hawaiian men, Hawaiian women, you're gonna tell me that if I support one track and not as Hawaiian as you? That's the nature. That's the root of that question. Mahalo for asking, bro. And then the basis of his question, the fact of his question is, how does federal recognition impact independence? It does not. You can do both, brother. Okay? So, and when you talk about fast tracking, and no disrespect to Dr. Trask, this is your Ohana. This was a published article in 1999 by Dr. Hamani K. Trask, co-founder of Alahui. The title of the article is Native Social Capital, The Case of Hawaiian Sovereignty in Kalahui. The whole article discusses federal recognition and why Hawaiians should have federal recognition as a Native tribe. Okay, and I know circumstances have changed.
This is not federal recognition.
I understand circumstances have changed, but the point is...
Don't try to misinterpret my sister's publication,
okay.
Mr. Price.
The point is, this is not fast track. This
lying,
process
Mr.
started
Price, you're lying.
The process is started
and I'm not talking about your definition of federal recognition. No.
I understand that. But the process for federal recognition was not one incident.
This is not federal recognition, Mr. Price, what you're pushing.
I'm not pushing anything. I'm talking about let's get to our facts and let's stop the mischaracterization so that our people, don't have to feel like they're less Hawaiian when they don't understand what's going on. Okay? That's what I'm talking about. Let's get to the facts. That's why mischaracterization is so deadly. It's deadly to our people. Okay? You cannot mischaracterize a political entity for the livelihood of our people. Aina, I agree with you folks. Aina, this
part
is
my people. Sister's work, Mr. Price.
Okay, I wasn't going to misquote, I was going to read a quote.
Sovereign. Yeah. Occupy.
I know that there's some folks in the line who actually have, they're actually not interested in talking about federal recognition. They actually want to learn more about independence. Can we ask some of those folks to please move forward? We'd like to entertain some of those questions.
Let's just go.
I'm
sorry. I'm going to just go with the next person.
Thank you. I grew up Malka on this building, and I covered facts. And the reason I covered facts is because I have been a plaintiff and civil rights attorney for 30 years. During several of those years, I was a judge. As such, when we read a document, which I have read, we look for two things. What is in the document and what is not in the document. Now, and so I'm one of those people that read the tens and tens of pages of the proposed rules as well as the established rules. What is not, well, this is an aside. We're having this forum, and I'm participating in this forum, but we are leaving aside a fundamental threshold question. Why does a nation, America, have the right to dictate to another nation, Hawaii, the way in which we are to form in order for the nation, the United States, to recognize the nation of Hawaii? In order to participate in this forum, we have to leave aside that threshold question. But I am not aware of anywhere factually in the history of the world or any nation has been able to dictate to another nation how that nation should be formed in order for that nation to recognize. More than your time. You do not respect the fundamental rules that we all agree to. So let me finish my question that is going to be directed to both panels. What is not in the DOI rules? The DOI rules do not speak about nation building. They do not use the word nation anywhere. Why is that significant? They only speak about government to government. What they do say is that if we form a Hawaiian government, if any other entity does not follow, well, first of all, you have to follow the DOI rules in order to be recognized as the Hawaiian government. And if there any government comes after that, it will not be recognized. So my question to both panels is this. We speak a lot about how independence and these rules establishing a Hawaiian government can coexist. I would like to know from both panels, how is that possible? How are we, if we do agree to support the Naiopuni Constitution, which is then going to formulate a Hawaiian government that can speak to the United States government, and then we build the nation, how is the independence of the nation supposed to be reconciled with this Hawaiian government? I have a question for this side and for that side.
Because there's many kingdom experts, advocates, whatever you like to call it. Stated. The kingdom was an internationally recognized government of multinational citizens. Both ethnic citizens.
What is?
Stay with it, no.
So, I'm telling you, I'm saying.
We're discussing the DOI rules.
You just asked how two could coexist.
No, we're discussing, you're here advocating the Department of the Interior rules for the formation of the Native Hawaiian government that will then be recognized by the United States. My question, you have to stay within that context, because it's not.
The rules,
why are you here?
The federal rules are for domestic recognition.
My question is,
are they to be
to establish a Hawaiian government, how do you reconcile that with independence and the formation of a nation?
So there's two separate sets of claims. It's two separate sets of claims. A native is the recognition of indigenous peoples was established through the UN process, which didn't come into existence until the 1940s. The kingdom was overthrown illegally in 1893. The kingdom's claims are not, will not be impacted by the claims of the native people. The native nation is not claiming to be the kingdom of Hawaii. That's the key.
If the Hawaii nation forms a government, its own constitution, under the DIO-DOI rules, will the United States government recognize that nation with a constitution that is separate and apart from the Na'iapuni? That's the question.
Separate from
Na'iapuni. So are you asking if there's two separate documents and two separate constitutions, which ones do the United States talk to in international relationships? That's the question. Which one? If there's two constitutions, which right now we're looking at...
The United States has already said the Kingdom of Hawaii does not exist in numerous United States cases, so I don't think that they would... They're never going to exist to acknowledge the Kingdom. What I'm saying is, our claims for a kingdom, we're not going to knock on the United States door and get recognized as a kingdom first. We're going to have to go in the international arena, which goes with what I said earlier. The international arena is where the kingdom claims take place. Simultaneously, we can work with the United States as indigenous people. Not to give up any rights, but to assert more rights and gain more access to it.
I know everybody is getting really deep, but I'm just going to say for a minute, let's talk story, okay? So I'm just going to ask really respectfully, can Josh moderate for this, and then you can just tell 1 minute, and then everybody can agree to that? Can we agree to try and keep it short, and then not talk over? Is that okay? Because this is a conversation, right? Y'all want to talk to them? So let's give it a chance, okay? Mahalo.
Understanding is with time. You're not going to be able to get to every single question. Just imagine those expectations, yeah? So out of respect for each other, yeah? If we could, and I want Mahalo to take up, probably tomorrow, but and he will continue to do this, but if we could ask a specific question so that the panel can answer the specific question, and then we can have a discussion on such specific question. Did you know?
Yeah.
We all agree to that? Mahalo.
I'm really longing to answer that question, okay? So I'm going to say, to answer the question that she has to ask for both sides, to ask how you can reconcile the Constitution. And I can say it's impossible. You can't, because it's not one building on top of the other. The way that this Constitution is written, there's tons of representation of Kalapui, there is the 1864 Kingdom Constitution. Those create the processes of which you identify the leadership. And then they're going to take these programs and they're going to run them. That's what the domestic federal recognitions are talking about. They'll run these programs. Is that something?
Everything together? Do we trust them as a people to listen to what you have? We are concerned.
And I think that's really a key factor, is that you can't reconcile the two of them. What's going to happen if you create a civil war?
Much of that love, I'm checking too. Okay? Our question, when I ask some specific questions, our speaker is going to have 2 minutes. Okay? We're going to stop them. I'm just going to tap them on the shoulder, but we're going to stop them and we're going to move on. Okay? Okay? We're going to. I really am mahalo you guys. Okay? Let's go to the next question, please.
What Indian tribe in the United States of America that's acquired federal recognition ever successfully then secured independence for the United States of America? The answer is none. The question I have, so those that are talking about new preparation for independence, we're precluded not only because there's never been a precedent by any Indian tribe to ever successfully do that, but secondly, there's a federal statute which precludes us if we are recognized as a federal tribe. This federal statute precludes us from pursuing independence. So on two counts, what you have just stated tonight is completely untrue, because no precedent has been set by a single Indian tribe that has achieved federal recognition. And secondly, federal statute, Title 12, does not allow us to move forward past federal recognition if we want to secure independence. So on both counts, you're wrong. So let's get our facts straight.
Was there a question? Okay, well, I'm gonna respond. You're right. However, like I said, a Native nation is not able to make the claims of the kingdom. However, if our people begin to build, and we build a government and gain resources, and we start to build, we can get international recognition and eventually evolve into the kingdom. If that was ever to be a choice.
There's not a single sentence in the DOI rule which would allow you to develop our lands. Where?
Look
on it. On 172 pages of the rule, where does it say anywhere that you can develop lands?
That's a great point that out. It's a good opportunity to educate once again on what the Department of Interior rules are about. The DOI rules are not a land-claim settlement. We would not want lands to be in that process. The DOI rule isn't even on us. The earlier speaker, there was a mischaracterization. The Department of Interior rules are for them. So it sets up a process how they would, if a Native Hawaiian government comes forward to have a government-to-government relationship with them, the DOI would have to follow Part 50, number 2. There are over 566 Native American tribes. Pretty out of mind. They have been going to the UN long before we have, and are still going to the UN. So, and holding on to their federal recognized status. What federal recognition does in reality, allows the Native people to take their assets and resources and control them up under Native control, rather than a state government or even a federal government having all that control. So there are the Lakota, the Navajo, all the federally recognized Native governments are indeed at the United Nations and should be at the United Nations fighting that fight. The real question, sir, is, name an Indian tribe that has achieved federal recognition, and sister, I really appreciate it, recognizes and understands how long the law process is for them. Name a Native government. These are smart people too. We're smart, they're smart, that have requested to be unrecognized. Not one. Not a one has said, I don't want my rights under the Indian Self-Determination Act. Sorry. Thank you.
Some education on that was Kalama, Mahalo Kalama.
So here are what my questions are, similar to questions that were asked on the Federal Regulation side. By the way, I'm very sincere about this, and I think those of you who know me know that when I do this, it is with sincerity. So my questions are, what are the benefits of independence? What steps are necessary to make it happen? Because I've already touched on that. I know a couple of processes that you suggested would be necessary. Who will write the governing document? Certainly, California had with input at one point in time. Input from the people to write the governing document. And lastly, how will return of ceded lands happen without recognition by the state or federal government? Because the fact of the matter is, right now, they have the lands. So under independence, how would you see that working? So I realize I've asked four questions. I don't know what minute each group you have to answer. But I would really appreciate that, because as I say, I came to learn more about independence. Mahalo.
I try to answer at least one of those questions, just to be fair to everyone else.
I'll give someone a model. And I'll talk in English this time. So because I don't. Independence, as far as how we get there, the steps that need to be taken, I'm not a political expert, but a step that I think that a crucial step that needs to be taken is the step of struggle. And not to say that we have been struggling, but independence is not something that we're going to ask for and it's going to magically appear. It's not something that I can show up to a meeting and testify and answer a question yes or no and think it's going to happen. Independence is something that we need to achieve as a people, that we need to fight for, we need to struggle for, we need to go through pain, emotional, spiritual, physical, whatever it is. That's what's going to have to happen. We have to hold on to Nui, that's one thing. And when I say hold on to Nui, I'm not saying sit on the side and wait. Yeah, hold on to Nui, make more time, make time, make time, make time, make time. Keep going, keep going, keep going. When you think you lose, try again. When you think you lose, try again. When you think you win, try harder. We've got to keep going. And so when I think about working towards independence, I mean, I know, kind of obvious, but I think about Mauna Kea. I think about Mauna Kea. We're talking about nation building. Kukulu Aupuni, that's where it happened. There's more nation building that took place at Mauna Kea between March and December of 2015 that is not taking place in whatever efforts Aloha and Kamehameha and Noia Mahalo, whatever lot they made. There's been nation building, education, there's awakening, there's awareness. And those are the kind of things that will allow us to achieve what we're going after. But it's a process. It's a process. And we've got to hold on to it. Now we've got to understand that we're in a position where we are only getting stronger. We're only getting stronger. But it was, if that's the best they got, we're getting beat. If this is the best America's got, we already got to beat because we're only getting stronger. Three generations ago, my kupuna signed the Kuwait petition. Kahikina, Kahakuwila, Nabolua, Makahue, Kumuhone. They signed that petition. And generation by generation, we became a little bit less calm, a little bit less kawaii. But the shift has already occurred, and it's turned. And I think that our generation, my generation, is in a better state than the generation before me because of the action, the struggles that they went through. And if I continue to struggle, my kids and my whole food and the generations after me, they'll be in a better position. But we got to struggle. We got to struggle.
Experiences from my family, many people close to me, online, they've struggled a lot. And I know you said that you acknowledge that there's been a struggle. I don't know how deep some people are willing to let the struggle go in order for they think the system is going to come so broken that people can suffer. I'm not sure to the extent people are willing to go, but I'm not willing to go to that extent. And I'm going to use education as one example for the educators over there. A practical solution, but potential solution to a $1 billion budget under the DOD that does not adequately fund grant programs. And I'm not advocating here. I say She asked for pathways, she asked for specific answers about independence. I haven't heard anybody ask these questions from an international independence arena. Under federal recognition, you would have autonomy with an educational system to negotiate with the state and the feds to get resources to administer your programs autonomously outside of the umbrella of the DOE. I just think that's a practical answer, potential solution.
My name is Willa Leonardi. I want to share with you what those of us who grew up in Hawaii said and are now DCs and what we're going to go through in the bottom line. I'm going to read from my poem what is being asked of us by the Department of Hawaiian Homes. Public hearing set for December on DHHL's proposed administrative rule changes. State of Hawaii Department of Hawaiian Homeland, notice of public hearings on proposed amendments to Title 10, Hawaii Administrative Rules. The Department of Hawaiian Homelands, DHHL, will hold statewide public hearings for Hawaii Administrative Rule amendments. The proposed amendments to the Title 10, Hawaii Administrative Rules, Department of Hawaiian Homelands, cover several topic areas, which include the use of DNA testing to help establish familiar relationships for the application and process and successorship designation, subsistence, agriculture lots, et cetera, et cetera. That is coming up on December 6th. I am to ask the question. The question is, on both panels, do you feel that a government agency should be making a rule as to who my mother slept with? That is the question. And that's how far they've lowered us. I find this government entity heinous and criminal to even make a rule as such.
It's been clear that the United States has only had their own personal agenda in mind. You know, they didn't take us over because they wanted to benefit us. They put us over because they wanted to benefit themselves. And every rule and every power that they printed has always been to benefit them and not to benefit us. You know, we could have tried to have a win-win, but there has never been an attempt for a win-win. There's been a lose and a win. And they're the ones who win. They're the ones who are acting like they're the boss of us. You know, like we said already, nobody gave them permission. My kupuna never gave them permission. I never gave them permission. My kids never gave them permission. So really, it's about us decolonizing our minds. We are not part of it. We don't want to be part of it because we are not former.
Well, my response is I agree 1,000%. And the answer to Andy's question is whether a state agency should be deciding those things or telling us what to do. I agree with who the answer is no. And that is why self-governance at the international arena through independence or at the domestic level through a recognized Native Hawaiian government is so important so that we are deciding these kinds of things ourselves. No, they should not, state agencies, the federal government should not be making decisions about DNA, blood, etc. Thank you.
Right now, it is 9:38. We're gonna change our rules just a little bit, if you guys will allow it. The questions, they're gonna have 30 seconds to just ask the questions. Yeah, and I should have did this a lot sooner. But please ask a specific question, then we can have the speakers answer, and then we're just gonna try to ask one question, and then we'll go move on. And I come, mahalo all of you guys' efforts, be patient.
My question is, it's where is the jurisdiction? We were invaded January 17, 1893. July 7, 1898, we became a territory by two pages. It was a joint resolution. Now, in U.S. constitutional law, the joint resolution has no boundaries outside the boundaries of the United States. So the question is, how does the federal recognition apply to the fact they have the state doesn't have the islands or meets and bounds? Dr. Williams and Chang proved that after 20 years. I'm just saying, where is the jurisdiction for an outside entity known as the state of Hawaii under federal recognition? It's not an entity that has the jurisdiction under two pages of the joint resolution. There's no treaty. That's the problem. There is no treaty. There is no treaty.
Mahalo. Does that answer the question? The jurisdiction?
The Department of Interior rule, once again, I will repeat, is not the establishment of a government. It is not a land claim. It does not deal with jurisdiction. It is purely very limited scope. It is the regulatory regulations over the federal government on how it will respond and assess criteria when recognizing and deciding to have a government-to-government relationship with whichever Native Hawaiian government decides and wants to come forward and present itself. The federal regulations are there, they sit there, they may sit there and never be accessed. So they don't, the state of, well, what is, in relation to the Auntie's question, federal recognition or federal acknowledgement or government-to-government relationship, once acknowledged, state is automatic, they don't have a choice because they are part of the system. County governments will not have a choice because they are part of the state agency. But the Department of Interior rules does not address land or jurisdiction, nor should it. Because that is a question of the Native Hawaiian government itself.
No jurisdiction, and so basically it does say in DOI rules that we yield to the plenary power. And so what we have in the international realm and also domestic within American law is that there's no treaty of annexation and that there was no vote in Congress to make us a part of the United States. So we have a legal basis that we will yield through this process.
My question has to do with climate change. So we just, America just elected a president who wants to dismantle America's commitments to address climate change. And so for me, that brings up another huge urgency to our ability in Hawaii to address climate change. Because scientists have said these islands are going to be impacted more than any other place on the planet. We are going to face that now, and I'm glad to hear you say, Robin, that you support independence eventually. But we haven't had any support in terms of dollars to help us do the work that we have to do to get there. I think we need to get there faster. Recent scientists also said that by 2036 we will see sea level rise in these islands. So, question is, will you support, and I ask Oba this question, will you support funding equal for independence to get that work done that was spent thus far on the Ataka Bill and every other effort for federal recognition?
Okay.
Are you ready? I'll ask a question. You know as well as I, as a participant in the half the room supporting independence, and was very adamant about any movement going forward needing to be an open process that engages all voices. So my personal question, my personal answer, based off of the answer and providing what is in the Constitution, is yes. Of course we can support that.
No, I'm asking the question, equal funding for pursuing independence as a citizen.
All pathways, yes. Just as we discussed in the
in regards to climate change, again, we know who is responsible for us. It's not the native people. In fact, it's the native people that scientists around the world agree will bring the answer to the problem. So again, we're going to that point of being part of the colonizing nation makes us part of the people who are destroying the land, versus if we were to do our own thing, like our supporters, we would continue to model Aloha Aina like they did for thousands of years.
I think the young lady brought up a good point about climate change. I just wanted to respond.
Sorry, you're right. Very good. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
They wanted to make up less than 25% of the general population of Hawaii, yet over 50% of the children in Hawaii's foster care system are Native Hawaiian. Half of those children are faced with non-relatives. Parents struggle to comply with Western-based services, and many do not unify with their children. How will your movement help to turn our children home to their families?
The Native American Indians raised this question only in the last 25 to 30 years. The Congress responded by passing the Indian Child Welfare Act, which gives to Indian children the right, when they are taken from a dysfunctional family, to be placed with a family that is Indian. At that time, we said, to ask for inclusion, we could not get it. Regularly, Hawaiian children are pulled out of their Hawaiian families. They're placed with Oriental families and Maoris. We do not have the right to place our children. But we tried to get in the law. It's like that brother that was a veteran talking about loyalty. I took 25 years of my life to fight for the right of Hawaiian vets and Indian vets to be able to have a benefit when they came out to build a home. Because the veteran benefit was given to all the veterans, but never to an Indian or a Hawaiian. Because they lived on trust lands that was communal lands for the people. The same is the case with the United States. There is no right to protect your children other than the Congress saying it. And when the Congress passed the Indian Child Welfare Act, they left out all the children that wasn't recognized. They left out the children of the Pueblos. It wasn't just the Hawaiian children, but to this day, we don't have that right. And that was another big deficiency that they left out of the Na'iapuni Constitution. We wouldn't have it under their federal recognition.
But actually, I think that the answer to your question is that federal recognition allows Native American Indian children to be placed in American Indian homes. So yes, federal recognition does support that you're asking
about. But it's not in our country.
It doesn't have to be in the Constitution. We're not recognized one. It doesn't have to be in the Constitution. It was not brought enough that it would be included in the statutory body.
It's not in the Constitution.
Go, Mike.
The practice among Hawaiians is that we mala ma'alo. So in our Hawaiian focused charter schools that have not been supported by the state or the federal government, we make sure all of our teachers are registered foster parents so that they can take the cakey home when they need to be mala ma'alo.
I am grateful for the DOI rule, not because I'm happy of what was in it, but because it brought Manapui together, period. period. We need to have more discussions like this, and I'm an Aloha you folks, and I'm an Aloha, and I understand that we need to go to a struggle, or through a struggle, and I'm getting to my question, but I'm worried about time. I have dedicated my life, my kupuna have dedicated my life to protect our natural cultural resources. I live it every day, and I see our native wildlife die every day, along with all of our resources. I see it dying, just like you guys do. Time is of the essence. Now I want to know, my question is, I want to go down the road right here. What are you folks individually willing to do to answer the tough questions if that is what you really want for independence? What are you going to do to work across the table instead of saying, this is my constitution, this is your constitution. I'm not going to give you the Kalahui constitution, you have your constitution over here. I want to know, how are we going to work together forward?
So how did they pass is my question. And my understanding is that pro-rule, the people who are in support of the rule passage, organized this postcard campaign where you just check off that you support it and mail in the postcard. And so, were the postcards counted more than the real life Kanaka? How did they get passed? Is my question to both sides. How do we explain that? Is that really self-determination? Maham.
The opinion is that the essence of self-determination is that the most powerful expression is important is in person. It's not the, maybe in person, it's not the only way to express support or opposition, but I think that you must understand that the DOI's job was to evaluate the content of the answers. So did you answer the questions being posed? Their question was, we are looking at promulgating a rule. What do you think about this? What do you think about this? Many of the oral testimonies didn't address those questions. It just said, go home. We don't want you here. So you didn't give them something substantial to say. You weren't answering the questions. You were just saying, go home. We don't want your rule. Okay, they noted that. But there was a lot of substantial testimony provided answering those questions that were posed. And I think that there were card campaigns on both sides. Yes, we saw cards for opposition and we saw cards for, and that's part of what Davis was talking about earlier, engaging. That is our civic duty. We should definitely be engaged. Whether you check a box, get out and write your testimony, do your oral testimony, it all counts. But it comes down to the content. Did you answer those questions that were posed by the DOI?
And the question that was posed was a flawed question in the first place because they are not, to repeat, the boss of us. So to come as the boss and act as the boss, if you're not the boss, then all I can tell you is for whom you are not the boss. When our kukuna signed the Pu'er petition, they had a keynote, they read their person, they put it in front of other people as witnesses, and many of them had ramifications because they were pro-Hawaii, they were pro the Queen, and many of them lost their jobs, especially those that are working for the state government. So our kukuna stood up and had the balls to stand up as Hawaiians and say Pu'er, and I think all of us Hawaiians should do the same.
How old is it and go home? No, we don't want it. Sounds pretty substantial to me.
We have four more questions after that. Mahalo, we're going to close this up for these last four questions. Mahalo, thank you guys for your guys' patience.
I do want to make sure that you know that if you go online, there were 5,124 comments that are public. So I encourage you to go online and read some of them out. Okay.
Mahalo.
You shoot up.
I guess my question is one that relates to the DOI ruling. I actually read 172 pages. And I want to ask you all, whoever read that thing, did any of you feel like throwing up? But sit to your stomach. Because I have never read anything in my life that made me sick to my stomach. When I read that thing, it is filled with generalizations, purposeful avoidance of facts, never once mentioned that Hawaii in 1843 was established as a sovereign nation. Why would you say, who wrote the DOI ruling? Who's the author of that thing?
DOI.
Yeah, and another thing is, if you read it, you will see things. Like how they say, oh, but nobody answered that question. They avoid things in there that are important facts of history. Why do we conjure up this something that would be read by people who are not educated about our history? And they'll say, oh, so that's something they're being here of the Native Hawaiians. Oh, okay. Kamehameha was able to unify the white islands under one kingdom, and then there was a few other monarchs after that were able to keep it going. That's the kind of thing that's said. Who wrote this thing? Who wrote the DOI ruling? Because they tried to put it forth as if it's a sovereignty, but it is not. It's filled with fallacies.
The question was, who wrote the DOI ruling?
So,
who wrote it?
The federal rulemaking is a long-standing process. It's not a new process.
Author,
can I please answer? So there are federal regulations done for housing. There's federal regulations done all across the federal government. I want to make sure I'm correct, because maybe it's part of why there's this contention. The regulations are not on us. The regulations are their regulations on them. And typically, the authors of federal rules depend on what the subject matter is. In this case, the subject matter is the trust relationship and the federal staff or the legal standing status of Native peoples. And so it involved not only the Department of Interior, it also involved the Department of Justice and attorneys. Long-standing folks that have experience. But again, what's important to say is actually the historical writing in those rules are pretty darn good. And second, again, I say those rules were not regulations on me, okay. They are regulations written by the federal government for the federal government.
It hasn't been settled. So my question is,
why has no one on the federal recognition side stood up visibly and said, we refuse to put our kingdom in this. You know, we refuse, we want to be very clear that this does not settle anything. I haven't seen that from anyone. I haven't seen the recognition. And so I'm wondering why hasn't there been a recognition of what everyone else is saying and what they're concerned about?
First, I want to touch on something I said when I first spoke. So I'm not up here, much as you guys may not believe me, because it's how we really divide. I am not an advocate for federal recognition, because I don't know what federal recognition is going to look like, because we haven't stood a government, we haven't held elections, we haven't begun to negotiate with anybody realistically as a Native government. At that time is when I will decide when I'm a supporter of federal recognition. It is a tool and a pathway that I'm willing to consider. Clarification. Now, to answer your question, it's in the first, I believe, the preamble of the Constitution. Everybody that supported the Constitution on a process moving forwards, it left independence on the table. It said that we can still pursue independence. It's specific, and that was a very hard-fought battle. That was a very hard-fought battle by many in the AHA to include that language in there. It is in there. So there's different opinions on the Hui, but they worked it out. Wow.
That
was your answer. We have said it. I said it.
Yes.
And also the DOI rules, the Part 50 rules, already answered the question. There is no necessity under federal recognition stand up. It cannot apply, does not apply to our international rights, our rights that remain within the kingdom. The Part 50 rules, in fact, kingdom individuals asked specific questions of the DOI in that ruling process, and the DOI answered them on that point to make sure that they are separate and they do not intertwine. But this is also why I want to say to the young lady, I support both. I support any funding for either to educate our people on either front, that we should continue going to the UN, just like other federally recognized Native nations are funding themselves to go to the UN. It is not or, it is and.
You know, there's only one UN expert in this room. You cannot rectify or justify these things. You can take the word independence and stick it in the paper, but it does not provide rights to people. It does not return their land or give them restitution for the overthrow. You can talk words, but it's not the same thing as saying we have our land. That is what the difference is. Instead of saying, if you want independence or if you believe in human rights, go to the United Nations. Wrong. We bring the human rights home. We stay home. You go
home. That if the you can all sign a document saying that they will absolutely refuse any type of government that in any way yields the independent nature of the Hawaiian Kingdom, that we will absolutely refuse any negotiation. And maybe we can start talking about this and say that yes, you can have two different pathways. So if you guys, are you guys willing to all agree on that? That every single 81 of you, that you will absolutely refuse any type of situation that will anyway.
I would sign up for something like that. I have to fight for pursuit of independence to be included.
That's an easy test.
It's a compromise. That's how the world works. I don't agree with you.
That's an easy test.
Okay, let's work on that. I'll fight. Okay.
So this question was already asked, but there was not really a clear answer given. And it was, in which case has federal recognition ever resulted in any of the Native American tribes achieving sovereignty or trading with other nations? Sovereignty in a real sense. Independence.
Thanks.
I think we did answer that. I think we did.
You
said it never happened.
Never.
But I clarified that the Native peoples is different than the claims of the kingdom.
Yes.
Okay.
I think that's a critical point. And also, there have never been an unrecognized Native group, and there are about 60 that are applying for recognition now. They have also not been recognized, nor have they achieved anything from the International Native Indigenous Body. Okay? Well, that's a serious letter. That's a serious guy. Because now the document is not going to happen, regardless of what they share, there isn't any.
We said there was
any who put a seat in my room.
And call them out. We're at overtime. It's 10 o'clock. I'm going to put my hat over here because we need some donations. We're going to continue this discussion, but somebody's got to pay the custodian. Aloha Aina will. So if those who want to help contribute to Aloha Aina so we can continue this discussion, please join right here.
How much have we made?
Let's keep going with our questions.
Aloha. My question. Why are you pointing out my banner?
Because she got all the money.
Yeah, well,
it's sorry for the shake, I'm putting some money in.
Yeah.
Hello.
Do you
have guys who work for Ohio?
Okay, people generous, you put money in there.
Mahalo everyone, mahalo.
I want to show how much money.
This one won't be on the right there.
You're on the end of the table, they might help it.
Okay, they're not far, here we
go.
There's the money. That's pretty good.
So my question is, hello, my name is Tyler. Can we as a people and both panels, can we make a commitment to start the process of reestablishing either a government or a kingdom? Minus the oppressor, because the way I feel, you cannot steal from my house, you cannot take from my queen, and you do what you did to my queen, and keep you sitting at the table with me, and you will tell me how we're going to start the government. We backwards. So Aole, you need to take that. You need to put a POI. Wait. Because we need to establish ourselves first and foremost. Minus the oppressor. So can we make a commitment as a people, as a Hawaii, to start a government?
Part of the reason why I engaged, and I'm sorry because I've got to hear it up here a couple of times myself, and I apologize. But part of the reason why I engaged in this process is because we gotta understand that everybody at these tables has worked, I'll speak myself because I want to let you know, their whole life for our lawful. Regardless if you were in agreement with what they do, they worked their whole life. We gotta talk to each other and respect. How am I for me losing my cool a couple of times? But I just want to reiterate that. We all here for the same reason. We all here because we know our people got to move up, okay? So we all need to commit to each other first. That's it.
Mahalo, mahalo, right on, brother. Mahalo. Hello, leaders. Early in the on field, I'm going to call my son, you know, my other son, Mahalo, Kelly. We're all here discussing the Constitution. My question to you guys is, who voted the participants in to write the Constitution? Nobody. When you write a constitution, you have to have delegates. Who's the delegates? It was participants. I had a vote for not one representative that could represent its people. Not one person could speak for me, because we had no delegates to vote for.
Where's the justice in that?
How can you say you're writing a constitution without delegates representing the people? Question, simple. How can you be appointed? How can you be appointed participants?
I understand that the process is broken. I understand. I know.
It was what?
But it's broken.
You're talking about my family's family at the beginning of time. It was broken?
Yeah, no, the process of money of money.
Okay.
Broken. We good? Okay? The process of money of money was broken. That's why I personally, and I don't speak for anybody else, I did not believe that the best way to approach that process was to disengage. That's me. And I don't judge anybody else who took their own pathway to disengage, protest, participate. I say for me, I wanted to get in there to see what work was being done and what was gonna come out. Now, I know that I didn't go in there representing anybody but my Ohana. That's it. Okay? And that's what I went in there and spoke on behalf of. So now and fought to ensure that nobody in there watching to make sure that nobody in there was gonna take that product and try to do anything that represented our people without taking it out to the people first. And I can assure you that that constitution will not have any impact on anyone unless it's voted on by our Wahoo or our potential Wahoo.
Okay, now, question is,
but why should it even be voted on when it was developed by a flawed process? I mean, I don't think it's, you know, as a teacher, I wouldn't allow you to take something that was HEPA and then tell you vote on it when you already know it was HEPA and you don't admit that the process is flawed. So that's not a constitution. You shouldn't call it a constitution because it was not created the way constitutions are created, which is too delicate. And certainly, some of the people, and I have to say my own students included, certainly would have never been delegates if there was a vote.
And that's those are legitimate reasons to not engage, but that is yet an individual choice. I don't speak for you, and you don't speak for me.
You used $32 million of all monies. All the trust money was allocated for you guys to do it.
So every Native Hawaiian is Native, and we all have our individual choices. And so I absolutely respect Cruz Manaho on that, that she did not like the process and she made a decision not to engage. I was not in the Aha, but I made a choice for my Ohana. I am going to engage.
People were paid to do that. They were receiving money from my trust money.
Thank you. This is from John Sorum. He said, do you see any chance of securing federal recognition through executive or legislative grants for Kojana?
That's not it.
It has to
be
the answer was a definitive one.
Yeah, they said no.
The answer was no.
Yeah.
Next.
Yeah.
Next.
Yeah.
And it's unnecessary. By January, June, March,
okay.
September, okay. It's unnecessary to achieve by any deadline.
My question has to deal with the recognition process here. I heard Bob and you've reiterated that recognition can still proceed forward. One, we can go for international claims, we can go for domestic claims in the United States. I limited my scope of question to page 47 of the DUI rule. It explicitly states that this recognition that will be provided to the Native Hawaiian people is not the same that their ancestors enjoyed via the Kingdom of Hawaii, which is a nation-to-nation status. Now, the other questions that were asked was, has any federally recognized tribe or non-recognized tribe, have they ever achieved nation status? Because I think what people are trying to understand here is if we somehow go down this route, what would be the process in which, if we take a DUI ruling and its status, will be that. But I also ask a further external to that question, is that what if both happens? And I'm just gonna pick up your wonder. What if any law and PNC joint government goes out and they come back, you know, in a couple weeks and they've got 5-6 countries full-blown recognition of the reinstatement of the kingdom. And what happens if your folks come out and you guys entertain a DOI ruling and it's signed by them and say, oh, what happens then? You're gonna have two processes standing over here. What is
that? That would be so awesome.
That would be civil war.
No, it wouldn't.
No, but the question that would be asked, and that's where I think you're the more qualified to ask this, is the question that the world is going to be asking is, who has the higher authority here? The
of injured party or the part of people that resided from that injured party seeking to create something new.
Dear Ms. Kim, to that part, but I do want to acknowledge your first question. Exactly. The DOHI rules on May 42 say this process, everything about it, has nothing to do, has no impact on the international arena. You made our point. The DOI said itself that this the Part 50 has no impact whatsoever on international
arena. No, my point was that it's about recognition. They're saying that the recognition that you will see is not talking about things, it's talking about the status of political stance. You won't have kingdom status.
Correct.
Right. That's my point.
That's why it's it is a dream.
But,
so
the
point is like Davis is
a good job. You can do both. If that's what happens, we're gonna be the luckiest people on earth, because I don't know where that else is that happening.
I think you have to basically look at the land, okay? Where does the land go? Who decides where the land goes? And they're going to make this decision. They're already negotiating, because the whole point of it is that this group of people are going to negotiate the land away. And you can't have two different authorities determining where the land goes. You can't.
I can't
I don't have to interrupt other people. So, that there is the land issue. Who gets to control that? And the question that really comes is, not just land, who gets to control these programs? And that's really the question immediately, is they're making a bid to control these programs coming in as schools, is one. If they're protecting the right versus right panel, the definition of who gets protected means service. You're talking about Aloha, you're talking about Oha, you're talking about Queen of the Oklahoma Children's Center, you're talking about Kamehameha School. They are going to be determining who gets control over those. And I have to ask, and I have to ask you guys, did you guys ask permission from all those people that you're going to negotiate on behalf of everybody in their one entity?
Who appoints Kamehameha School trustees right now? Yeah.
Not Hawaiian.
Aloha. Next question, sir. Aloha. In that 173 document, did state in the article that Hawaiian sovereignty has never been abrogated or relinquished. Yep. That's a fact. Neither has Hawaii been compensated, nor did they get consent. We're talking about theft. In any, by any other language, you need to talk about damages, not about continuing to be a ward or a part of the franchise that's signed on for the debt. Because as long as you're attached to the debt, you're going to be just flip-flopping our guns, and we're not really sovereign until we issue our own currency again. We'll be sovereign. We can't be using the Federal Reserve Note exclusively. This is why the Indians don't have any sovereignty. They gave it up when they gave up their wampum. So where's Hawaii's wampum? Where's the instrument that makes it indeed a sovereign? You have relations with Japan. Japan was the first nation recognized by Hawaii. That's an international agreement and recognition. There's Hawaiian groups working on relations with other nations. That's sovereignty. To beg the United States or to accept any thing that they got to say, you capitulate to what they say. So you have the status to say, recognize it, execute
it. Well, my name is Jeremy. Put out some information. There has always been a constitution in the kingdom of Hawaii. There has always been a seat in the Senate in Washington, D.C. for the kingdom of Hawaii, which has been empty for many of years. Thank you.
So, from what I heard from the Frederick side is that, you guys are willing to work side by side with the independents, right?
Absolutely.
So So was there any money allocated to the independent site, to the money that the guys have received for their process as well?
That, I'm not representing the Office of Affairs or anything, I just have something to say about that, but funding is coming from all over.
No, but my question is, the funding that you got to create your constitution, was any of those monies allocated to independence groups to support their independence as well?
No, but it's not my understanding that. And that decision, regarding your statement earlier about the $33 million, and just so you folks know, I am an aide to Trustee Daniel, who's not going in to help Office of Foreign Affairs trustees. The only trustee who voted consistently, though, who voted against Kamei Lovalu and Kali Okuni. So I'm not here representing any of his beliefs or anybody else from Office of Foreign Affairs or the practitioners of Kali Okuni here at the individual capacity. Those decisions were made before I got there. OHA adopted a policy in 2001, Board of Trustees, to support federal recognition. Now, to clarify, again, if I don't agree with how the money was spent to lobby and promote federal recognition, I cannot disagree. But understand that, you know, to villain, in my opinion, the people who have made those decisions were villainized. And you gotta understand the context of the history that YC Kai Kano, which came down in 2000, threatened every single piece of Hawaiian programming that exists today. And it was done in a mad rush to push the Akapa bill and do everything they could to protect Native Hawaiian programming, because everybody thought they were all going to fall quickly as a result of lawsuits. And there were lawsuits against every single trust, Hawaiian homelands, Kamehameha schools, OHA. And as you know, Kamehameha schools, 20,000 people marched to try to overturn a Supreme Court decision in 2005. And the only reason why I never got to the Supreme Court was because Kamehameha schools had to settle, cost them $X million. So just take it to context. Before people make judgment, take it to context why decisions were made. Now, there's nobody out there trying to sell, that I know of, trying to sell our people under the bus and sell nobody out. Everything has been done for a reason. There's next problem.
So just to address that, as far as the money goes, so yes, we did not receive a single dime. And that's because funding and grants are based on giving reward to that which you want to achieve. And so, essentially, what they want to achieve is that we have a very compelling case, because the United Nations will not support a nation to dismantle like the United States. They won't support it. So they require us to give up our sovereignty. So that's what they're paying for. The $33 million is to pay for giving up our sovereignty, because we have, under American law, their own laws, that we are an independent nation. So the argument is we will not challenge the boundaries of the United States, because we have never been a part of the United States.
I'd like to direct this question to Brock. Now that we have heard just recently tonight that the Aipumi conference was broken, I would like to know if that's the case, and that the constitution that was created by non-delegates, non-elected delegates, and I understand by international law that in order to conduct or create a constitution, you have to be an elected delegate for the government. So my question to Robin, if that is so, why did you get $7 million from the Office of Hawaiian Affairs to ratify that constitution?
Okay, so first of all, there hasn't been a ratification of any constitution. I don't know what $7 million you're talking about.
It's in the Hawaii Free Press.
Oh, that's a reputable.
OHA has not provided any money. I can speak on this from my capacity over the law. There has been no money provided for any ratification process.
Has not been.
So you're calling this article a liar?
Yeah. Absolutely.
100%.
Hawaii Free Press is not, I wouldn't, you know, bank my kids on that.
Okay. Andrew Walton.
So you say this is false.
And I would also encourage every independent advocate here to advocate to the Board of Trustees and Office of Foreign Affairs to change that policy that I mentioned in 2001 to include supporting international recognition.
And to stop reading Hawaii Free Press.
So I don't believe it.
$30 million is more than we have to pay. $33 million
Well, everyone, I really appreciate and I'm all of you for your patience. We're going to, if you would allow also us to circle up, let us pull in, and to pull off the law, say our closing pull in, let us leave all this energy here so that when we go home, we can leave all of this here and have our same travel. Right?
Mahalo, Joshua Noga.
Oh.
United went long. We've been live. Went live 3 hours and 40 minutes. Mahalo to Aloha Aina. Big mahalo to Josh Nonga. Big mahalo to the speakers. Absolutely. This is really good. Next time we should try and be here. If you're from Outer Islands, maybe this will come to you. So thank you for joining us. Thank you. I'm going to mount this up on YouTube eventually. Hey, there's the man. Pono ke aloha. I'm gonna cut away now. Thank you so much.